winter of 1974-1975 became a milestone in the long history of the longships on the Great Lakes of North America. It was the first time that shipping was conducted all winter long. Since the days when only the Indians and the early explorers were paddling their canoes over these waters, the dream has been to be able to carry on the commerce of the lakes region throughout the winter. While it is true the boats of only one company were operating through the full winter, the accomplishment marked the beginning of year-round seasons on the Great Lakes, including a long-standing dream of someday being able to pass overseas ships through the St. Lawrence Seaway to the lake ports in winter. The first winter of year-round shipping was carried out by vessels of the United States Steel Corporation, with the help of the United States Coast Guard and the Army's Corps of Engineers. Using the Coast Guard icebreakers Mackinac and South Wind, along with information fed to captains from radar-equipped aircraft, the battle moved Minnesota iron pellets from the Lake Superior ports into Whitefish Bay, through the Sault Ste. Marie locks, down the St. Mary's River into Lake Michigan, or the steel mills at the south end of the Big Lake. Season on the Great Lakes, brought about by the determination of the shipping interests, has astronomical economic implications for the states which border the lakes. And the historic events of the winter of 1974 and 75 constitute only one more chapter in the fascinating story of the great ships of the Great Lakes. And this is Lake Michigan off Chicago. The ship is the Norwegian training vessel Christian Radich, down the St. Lawrence Seaway for a visit to the inland seaport Chicago. For 100 years, sailing ships called at the ports of the Great Lakes. So, half a century after the end of sail as a significant mover of goods on the Great Lakes, sail once more is furled on the Sweetwater inland seas. Region of North America has been a highway for more than 300 years. At first, the lakes were the route of the French explorers. Then came the fur trappers, to be followed by soldiers and settlers, all in the ships of the last century and this. In the middle and late 1800s, the sailing fleet on the lakes carried the region's expanding commerce. Photographs from those days show the extent of the lumber trade, with the cities which ringed the lakes built by the lumber brought down from the North Woods by the lumber hookers. Of course, the sailing ships carried other commodities, iron ore, limestone, and grain, not to mention whiskey. As the 19th century progressed, the steamboats began to carry more and more of the lake's burden. And it is a fact of history that much of the great migration from Europe to the American Midlands came by lake steamer. The ships brought our great-grandfathers to new homes along the shores, and they heard the sailors sing their sea chanties, which were brought from the oceans and adapted for the lakes. As the sailing fleet disappeared, the steamboats connected the lake cities together. Still, in the memory of many around the southern end of Lake Michigan are the boats of the Graham and Morton line and the Goodrich Steamship Company. These provided both passenger and package service to such ports as Chicago, Michigan City, St. Joseph, and Benton Harbor. A boat which ran for both Goodrich and Graham and Morton was the city of Grand Rapids, Built in 1911, she ran until 1932, connecting Lake Michigan ports. Probably the best known of the Goodrich Line vessels was the Christopher Columbus, built for service from the Chicago Loop to Jackson Park during the Columbian Exposition of 1893. But at one time or another, after her World's Fair service, she was seen in most of the major Lake Michigan ports, and then ran into the 1930s on a Chicago to Milwaukee connection. The Christopher Columbus was the only passenger vessel built on what was known as a whaleback hull. The curved contour of the hull was said to make for an easier passage through the rough waters of Lake Michigan. This one vessel is said to have carried more passengers than any ship that ever floated anywhere. The whaleback hull was no guarantee against trouble. The Henry Court, a freighter, piled up on the breakwater at Muskegon during a December storm in 1934. Her crew of 25 was taken off with the loss of one life. But the last trip of the Henry Court is only one of many lake tragedies. Disasters came by way of fire. The old wooden boats or those with wooden superstructures were particularly prone to burn. This is the harmonic of the Canada steamship lines at Point Edward on the St. Clair River near Sarnia on July 17th of 1945. No lives were lost in the harmonic fire, but a sister ship, the Noronic, took 104 lives when she burned at Toronto on September 16th of 1949. Nobody ever knew what started the blaze, but the tragedy was only too familiar on the Great Lakes. On the lakes took place in the Chicago River near Clark Street on July 24th of 1915. The excursion steamer Eastland rolled over at her dock and 835 people died. Excursions on the lake were popular then, and the Eastland was one of several bearing picnic crowds heading for an outing at Michigan City. What made her capsize has been a matter of controversy ever since. However, even before the accident, she had a reputation among sailors as being top-heavy. But it wasn't all tragedy on the lakes by any means. As in other areas of transportation, the mishaps grabbed the headlines. But the day-to-day successful operations were the rule. And for years before the proliferation of the automobile and the fast highways, one could take a boat from almost any port on the Great Lakes for connections to almost any other port. And on some of the ships, there was good food, singing, and dancing. Said to be the largest side-wheel steamboat ever constructed, the Detroit and Cleveland Navigation Company came out with the Greater Buffalo and the Greater Detroit. They ran between their namesake cities. Coming of World War II, the Greater Buffalo was rebuilt to become the aircraft carrier Sable. And another Great Lakes steamboat, the C&B of the Cleveland and Buffalo line, was transformed into a flat top and renamed the Wolverine. Both ships trained pilots for the Navy. And during the war, the Wolverine operated on Lake Michigan from the Great Lakes Naval Training Station.
Blast! and soon across the ocean clear, our gallant bark shall bravely steer. For there we part from freedom shore tonight, a song we'll sing for home and beauty bright.
Since the Big Rivers and the Great Lakes made a natural barrier for the railroad lines, in several areas where a bridge was not practical, railroad car ferries were put into service. This is the car ferry Lansdowne in the Detroit River. Launched in 1884 for the Grand Trunk Railway, the Lansdowne for years was the oldest ship operating on the lakes. She ran through the 1960s, then was retired. Other railroads operated car ferries across Lake Michigan, among them the Ann Arbor Line and the Chesapeake and Ohio Railroad. A popular trip for motorists was the Muskegon to Milwaukee run of the Milwaukee Clipper, a venerable steamboat which began life as the Pennsylvania Railroad's Juniata. Now, the Juniata, one of three sister ships which included the Tyonesta and the Octorara, was built in 1905. The three vessels ran as the Anchor Line until 1936. Now, even the Juniata, as the Milwaukee Clipper, runs no more. Reminiscent of the great storm of 1913 was the November 1966 storm on the lakes, where the car ferry City of Midland was grounded on a bar off Ludington for several days. She had 128 passengers and crew members on board. The Rowan Company tug, John Purvis, helped free her, but this same storm took the Bethlehem Steel Company freighter, Daniel J. Morrell, in Lake Huron, leaving but one survivor. This is a photograph of the Daniel J. Morrell, which broke in two and sank in Lake Huron on November 17, 1966. Her stern half has been found and photographed on the bottom in 218 feet of water by Dick Race of the Hydrographic Survey Company of Chicago. The Morrell was running light in one of those ferocious November storms. It is theorized she became bridged between two tremendous waves, allowing her middle to crack and break. She sank within minutes. She lies not far from the wreckage of the Collier Argus, which sank in the legendary storm of November 11, 1913, with her entire crew of 25. 11 ships were lost in that storm, with a total loss of 244 lives. Several other ships were driven ashore. On November 18th of 1958, the ore carrier Carl D. Bradley was lost in Lake Michigan with all 33 hands on board. Then in early November of 1975, a 729-foot ore carrier, Edmund Fitzgerald, disappeared in a tremendous storm on Lake Superior. The Fitzgerald was launched in 1958 by the Great Lakes Engineering Company at River Rouge, Michigan, as these rare films show. The Fitzgerald, one of some 50 long ships built after World War II, apparently broke up carrying a full load of ore pellets and sank before anyone could get off a distress message. Her normal routine was a once-a-week round trip between Taconite Harbor, Minnesota, and Toledo, Ohio. She carried a complement of 28 officers and men, all of whom were lost. While the great storm of 1913 was the most disastrous in Lake's history, the fact that three huge ore carriers have met with disaster since 1958, in accidents which apparently took place very fast, is of concern not only to the Coast Guard, but shipping interests which want to operate the vessels all year round. And the nagging question continues. Is there something wrong with the design or construction of the long ships of the Great Lakes? In the days of passenger steamboats on the Great Lakes, it was popular to take a boat ride. The auto highways hadn't been built in such profusion then. The Pablo Island steamboats on the busy Detroit River were typical of the day or evening excursion service. Night or several day cruise on the Great Lakes was available on many boats over the years. At one time, there was service on the lakes from the major ports to any other major port. Peculiar to Great Lakes navigation, sailors often were put overboard by derrick to assist in landing the vessels, like this docking at Sault Ste. Marie. The Canadian Pacific's cruise ships, Keewatin and Assiniboia, were Lakes passenger boats which maintained their early century charm until their last days in the 1960s. The two connected with trains at Port McNichol on Georgian Bay and trains from Winnipeg at Fort William on Lake Superior. Today, the Keewatin is a museum at Saugatuck. While one can ship today on an overseas vessel plying the seaway, lake passenger service, as it was known for over 100 years, is gone. Passenger steamboat South American of the Chicago Duluth and Georgian Bay Transit Company became the last of the Great Lakes cruise ships. When she finished her season in 1967, an era ended. She and her sister ship, the North American, along with former Goodrich steamer Alabama, were queens of the lakes. We'll be right back. it was Michigan City, although they seldom called there. Mostly their majesties were seen from Buffalo and Detroit to Chicago and Duluth from around 1913. And somehow, the lakes aren't the same. If passengers aren't moving on the Great Lakes these days, cargo certainly is. One of the early cargoes when shipping began to be meaningful for the Midwest of both Canada and the United States was grain. Today, the grain continues to pour into the holds of Great Lakes ships, and while this one, the Troy's Dock, is no longer on the lakes, the grain still travels in ever larger ships.
We'll be on our way when the wind does blow.
A-hee-a-ho, are you most done?
Just one big blast and away we'll go.
So clear away the track that the bull giant run with a hay rig-a-jig in a low back car. A-hee-a-ho, are you most done with Liza Lee all almighty? So clear away the track that the bull giant run.
Other bulk commodities when include cement, like that carried for years in the John L.A. Goster. Today, larger ships trade in cement to such places as St. Joseph, Michigan. In 1896, the whaleback John Erickson ran in the bulk cargo trade for Upper Lakes Limited until the mid-1960s. Her triple expansion engines, after years of service on the lakes, still ran like a fine watch. Alexander McDougall's pig boat, Meteor, of the Cleveland Tankers Line, came the honor of being the last of the whalebacks. Into the late 1960s, the Meteor still ran out of Indiana Harbor and occasionally got stuck in the midwinter ice off Benton Harbor. The largest and deepest and coldest of the Great Lakes is Lake Superior. The mighty Gitche-Gumee of Longfellow's narrative poem, Hiawatha, was for the Chippewas the big sea water. From the iron mines of the Lake Superior country has come the red iron ore, first by sailing ship, then by the long ships of the Great Lakes. At Duluth, Marquette, and Escanaba, the red iron ore and the limestone has gone into the holds of the fleet for more than a century, and the ships only get bigger. They bring the raw material for the steel industry at Burns Harbor, Gary, Indiana Harbor, Chicago, Detroit, Ashtabula, and Conneaut.
The young fellows who follow the lakes in iron ore vessels your livings to make. I shipped in Chicago, goodbye to the shore, bound for Escanaba and red iron ore, dairy down, down. moon, it's high derry down.
As the locks at the Sioux are increased in size, the ships become bigger. This is the Stuart J. Court. At 1,000 feet long, the largest ore carrier on the Great Lakes. She's on her maiden visit to the Bethlehem steel plant at Burns Harbor in 1972. This one ship brings more than 2 million tons of iron ore pellets to the Northern Indiana steel mill each year.
September the 17th day, $2.25 was all they would pay. But on Sunday morning from the North Branch did take the schooner E.C. Roberts out into the Lake Derry Down.
In June of 1959, another dream of lakemen was realized. The widened and deepened St. Lawrence Seaway is dedicated by Queen Elizabeth and President Eisenhower. Moving past Detroit to Lake Michigan and Chicago, the Navy cruiser Macon and several destroyers taking part in the opening celebrations. Since 1959, each year the tonnage of goods interchanged by the Seaway from the North American midsection to all parts of the world has increased. Indiana has a stake in that, with its developing Port of Indiana. From the second decade of this century until the 1960s, both the North American and South American sailed the lakes in summer cruise service. They were known as the ocean liners of the Great Lakes. Today, the North American lies at the bottom of the Atlantic Ocean. She was being towed to become a school ship along the eastern seaboard when she just disappeared. So the North American has followed the sailing ships into the sunset.
Today's lake boats are not as colorful, they are more efficient. And the Great Lakes remain the vast water highway of two nations. So the story of the great ships of the Great Lakes continues as it has since the Indians and the explorers first paddled their canoes over these same waters.